still coming in. Did you ever notice the happy sound when everybody's just sort of conversing, talking?
Happy.
You know, it's a nice, nice sort of crowd. Nice to see everybody. Christine, thank you so much for playing for us this morning. I'd also like to thank Judy Tim and Recalco for filling in. I guess that's sort of a good thing or a bad thing because it takes three people to replace Molly. So, just saying, I don't know. So welcome friends, visitors, guests. We have a great day for us this morning. Announcements are in your bulletin. If there's anything else anybody'd like to say, I think Peggy wants to say something, so come on up, Peggy.
Thank you.
Thanks, good morning. Some of you know how much we support Meals on Wheels, and we want to thank the congregation for helping us print the posters, so your generous gift is appreciated. We printed 100 posters to be handed out. Our benefit concert is Wednesday night, the 24th at 7:30 p.m. at the Methodist Church in Stroudsburg, and you're all invited. It's a free concert, free will offering. It's kind of fun. Bob Ray and I are both singing in the chorus, and it's a selection of a variety of music. So come if you can, and we'd be happy to have you. Our faith fair is moving along, and anyone who has cakes or goodies, please wrap them so they're sanitary. And have them either Friday between 3 and 6 p.m. or anytime Saturday morning. Janice is running the cake table, for which we appreciate that. And the flea market table, of course, things are appreciated at that time on Friday when things are a little bit, we can pack the church with the goodies that you bring. We so appreciate the congregation's support on the faith fair, and we'll see you there on the 10th of August. One more announcement.
Next Sunday.
And the Sunday concert. How could I forget? The duo of Nicole and Ruth. They will be here Sunday night, the 28th, at 7 p.m. So we hope to see you then as well. Thanks.
Anybody else? Okay. If not, would you please rise?
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen.
Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. We start with our first hymn. Lord, speak to us that we may speak. It's in your Lutheran Book of Worship, number 403.
Thank you.
our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
First reading this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 23 verses 1 to 6. Here Jeremiah talks to the kings as if they were shepherds. So when he mentions shepherds in the reading, switch it to the bad kings. Anyway, here we go. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people, It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So will I attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to my fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they will not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this morning is Psalm 23. We read it responsively. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want.
The Lord makes me lay down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters.
You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will feel no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Our second reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 22. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcised by those who were called circumcised, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at the time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Jesus Christ, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall that is the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinance that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came to proclaim, and he proclaimed peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access to one spirit, to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
gospel today is taken from Mark chapter 6. Glory to you, O Lord. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went out in a boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized him, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And Jesus began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, the people again at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into the villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged Jesus that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched were healed. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
So today's lesson is about a shepherd. Do you know what a shepherd is?
A person who
takes care of sheep. And so that David, who wrote a lot of the Psalms that we have, he wrote this psalm because he was a shepherd. And so he did take care of sheep. So what do you think they have to do? What does a shepherd have to do?
Take care of sheep.
Count sheep. They take them out to have places to eat, right? And what happens if a bear comes, or that would be around here, a wolf or something? The shepherd has to take care of the sheep and make sure the wolf doesn't get to the sheep, right? And what happens, JJ, if the sheep falls down in a crevice, and the sheep is down there, and he's, what does the shepherd have to do? He has to go get him. And he has usually a crook, you know what that is, like a cane with a hook on, and he can put that around the sheep's neck and pull him up into safety. So do you think the sheep like the shepherd? Yeah, I think they really do, yeah. And so what we read this morning, Miss Peggy read this morning, was one of our favorite psalms of King David. And it is, "The Lord is my shepherd," and compares us to always taking care of us. And we were out skiing out west a long time ago, And we were looking for the Great Salt Lake. We were in Utah. And guess what I saw? We saw a shepherd with sheep today, in this day and age. And he actually had sheep that he was walking towards. And we had to ask him directions. And he could tell us directions, but all these sheep were just following him. And I was like, I didn't know anybody did that today. But indeed, he did out there. So that's pretty amazing, right? Yeah. So I want you today just to read and bring your good reader and JJ, your good one. And Tegan's learning because she's going to go to kindergarten. So I want you just to read this little shepherd. When you read one line in the shepherd, Psalm 23. "The Lord is my shepherd, I'll help you." Can you read it? Right here. Because we always go through our reading. "The Lord is my shepherd." See it right here? "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters." So make sure I have lots to drink. And so that's just, is that good? Good job. JD, you want to read a few lines? Nope? Okay. But that's it. That's the thing. And you know, whenever we have celebrations here, or sometimes celebrations of life, people have passed, this is usually part of it. We always hear that. The Lord is my what? Shepherd. Good. So I have something special for you today. You're not big horse, unfortunately. Actually, I saw it.
Thank you.
So I have for each of you a little booklet that says, "The Lord is my shepherd." It's only 4 pages long. Got it? You don't see Jeremy anymore, right? No. Okay. I actually have two more. I'm going to give one to your friend. Another one for your friend? Okay, another one. And I have coloring pages for you, too. And this one, it's 2 pages. One fits in the other one. I tried to do it on the printer, but somehow they're all going upside down. I'm sorry? Sure. That's not good. You want two? Thank you. Okay, let me give it to you, Jeff. The coloring page? Heavenly Father, thank you for these wonderful children, for having them here today with us. Thank you for teaching us that the Lord is always our shepherd, will always walk us beside still waters and take care of us all of our lives. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. This one fits in here, for sure. See if there's one. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy.
You're welcome.
So today we talk a lot about crowds and groups and flocks and all of that. But I got a question for you. This is just a raise your hand question. How many of you ever said, "Leave me alone"? I only saw a couple hands. Nobody's ever said. And listen, I've said that to everybody. I've said it to my parents, said it to my kids. God knows I've said it to my wife. I've said it to friends. I've said it to coworkers. Sometimes we just want to be left alone. But I think Peggy or maybe Sarah might tell us that sometimes that's not really what we want. We don't really want to be alone. We say that because we're frustrated or angry, because we can't do what we wanted to do, and we sort of maybe feel sorry for ourselves or embarrassed and just want to be left alone. So then I started thinking about today's lesson. Do you realize Jesus is never left alone? Well, a few times. In the Bible, if you go on Google and you go, "Jesus alone," you'll only see 3 or 4 passages. They're pretty much always the same. Jesus goes away to pray by himself. In the morning, at the end, at Gethsemane, when he's with the disciples, he takes Peter, John, and James with him, goes a little further, but then goes yet further alone. And if you think about it, Jesus isn't really alone then either, because he's praying to God and God is with him. So I got to thinking, how many times do you think about Jesus in the crowd? Where does that start? I'm going to stretch your imagination a little bit when we start talking about crowds too. This is not a crowd. This is not a crowd. But sometimes this, and really this, can be a crowd. Jesus tells us, "Wherever 2 or 3 are gathered in my name, there I am also." So I guess a crowd can be as little as 2. So where did Jesus' crowd start? Right at his birth. He was born in Bethlehem. Joseph and Mary went there and couldn't get a room because it was crowded. So where were they put up? In the stable. But that was crowded too. Keep in mind that at an inn, they have to have cows or goats and chickens. They're kept in the stable. Mary rode a donkey. That was kept in the stable. The other people who were in the inn, the overflow crowd, they didn't get there all by walking, although some might have. So they came by ox cart or goat cart, or they rode a donkey. And they were in the stable as well. You see, the stable was crowded. And Jesus was born to a crowd. And then came the shepherds and the wise men. And it was more crowded. Okay, let's move on in Jesus' life. When he was 12, we're told that Jesus went to the temple. He went with his family and a big crowd. And we knew it was a big crowd because when Mary and Joseph left, they were down the road a ways and realized that Jesus wasn't with them. There was enough people that Mary and Joseph had lost their son in a crowd. So they went back to the temple. And where was Jesus? You remember? He was teaching in the temple to a crowd. Now we skip ahead from 12 to the time Jesus is baptized. In the middle time, though, Jesus was living in Nazareth, a town, a crowd. But when Jesus is baptized, if you read the Bible, he goes through the people to John, because there was a crowd there already listening to John, and John had his disciples. So there's another crowd. The next part of Jesus, we hear about this miracle at Cana at the wedding. Remember that? Oh, another crowd, where he turns water to wine. There are crowds throughout Jesus' life. They follow him around. And this is no accident. Jesus is a crowd master. He knows how to deal with a crowd. In fact, he wants the crowd. You may never have really thought about this, but when he sends the disciples out to talk to the various people and tell them about what's going on, those people tell Jesus is going to be at this place or that place so that they can come and see him. Listen to him. Meet him. You see, Jesus didn't have a Twitter account. So he didn't even have flyers. So the only way he got the word out was through the word of mouth. So he lets people know that he's coming through his disciples. People hear the word. They come and see Jesus. Now, I think I find this really interesting that God shows his love and grace when he manifests it through Jesus in crowds through Jesus' compassion. Jesus shows love and compassion. Sure, he heals people and he shows his love and compassion that way. But he also preaches of God's love and compassion. He tells the people, and some of them listen. The neat part about Jesus' life is he not only says what's happening and tells you what can happen, but he shows you God's love as he heals the sick, the lame, the leper, the people with demons. And this continues through all of the preaching. It's how God gets the word out. It's how you and I get the word out. You are asked as disciples to spread God's word by voice. Tell a friend, tell a neighbor. And this is what they do. For those of you who were here last week, you remember that one of the lessons that we got was not everybody will listen. You can tell things to people, but they won't listen to you. And this was true of Jesus' time as well. Jesus knew that everybody who listened would not follow him. Certainly the Sadducees and the Pharisees that were there to find fault with Jesus didn't listen. But Jesus told enough people that enough people listened. And the crowds continue, and they got bigger and bigger. 4,000, 5,000. They got so big that they held a parade for Jesus. Everybody turned out, a big crowd. I don't know about you, but when I hear the word crowd, large groups, I get a certain amount of angst. I'm not really great at being in huge crowds, but Jesus was. He wanted those crowds there so they could hear the word. Even the bad crowds. Because there are bad crowds, as we all know. There was the crowd at Nazareth, where they wouldn't even listen to a person from their own town. And yet Jesus used that to show us that he escaped that crowd, that you need to move on when people won't listen to you. The crowd at the parade, well, some of that was also the next big crowd. And that was the crowd on Good Friday. The crowd that yelled, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" You know, that was part of the plan as well. Think about it. If only one person was there yelling, "Crucify him," do you think that Pilate would have listened? And God's plan, unfortunately, was for Jesus to be crucified for you and for me to save us from our sins. There was yet other crowds. There were the people that walked by the cross and heckled Jesus. There was also that small group that stayed below him. His mother, Mary, Mary Magdalene, one of the disciples. Jesus does not want you to be alone. And you are never alone, even when you ask to be. Jesus is always with you. He's with you from the day you were baptized, and probably before. But when you were baptized into the life of Christ. And that meant that Jesus, as much as your parents or anybody else, vowed to be with you. So when you say, "I want to be alone, leave me alone," and everybody does leave you alone, you're not. Jesus is always with you, even when you don't want him to be. At one point in time in all of our lives, we've probably turned our back at God, raised our fist to the sky, and swore at heaven. But you weren't alone. You turned your back on Jesus, but he never turns his back on you. He's always there with you. He is your crowd. Whether you're alone, or in a group, in a congregation, or even a mob, Jesus is there for all of us. And isn't that a great thing? We are part of the Jesus crowd. So let's rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
We'll continue with our next hymn.
Thank you.
join me as we can say you the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
One in the communion of saints, and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer. For the Church of Jesus Christ in this and every land, through the One who is the cornerstone of a firm foundation, join us together and build us up as a temple of mercy and peace. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the creation, cause new trees to be planted. Restrain the melting of polar ice caps. Save land from destruction. Let the shepherd tend her sheep. Raise up from among us caretakers of all that you have made. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the leaders of nations and heads of tribes. When peace seems far off, bring it near. Where justice seems fleeting, bring it to light. Where discord seems relentless, bring harmony. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the health and well-being of families, friends, and neighbors. Heal those who are sick. Give courage to all who struggle with addiction. Touch with your tender care all who reach out to you in pain. Especially today, we remember Tom, Valerie, Pastor Michael Ryan, Nancy, Artie and Dick, Ron, Phyllis and Jim, Bob, Mike and Janet, Billy and Rosemary, Deb, Shirley, Philip, Tom, Jack, Gail and Bob, Sue, Jim, Jen and Rachel, Judy, Diane, Donna, Roger, Cheryl, Brenda, and Hope, and those we name aloud or in our hearts before you now. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For this assembly and for the faith communities represented this week at the ELCA Youth Gathering, nurture the faith of young people as they encounter new experiences and people. Break down dividing walls and inspire collaboration among people of every age. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving for those who have died, make us certain that in Christ we are no longer strangers and aliens, but citizens with the saints in the household of God. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the One who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of God's peace.
Life torn and dirty, spread God's light in the darkness. Reach out and let the smile of God touch through you.
Thank you.
peace. You are the body of Christ.